Today, I want to share something which is considered important and yet also at the same time sensitive. On Friday night, as I dwell in the presence of the Lord, as I sit down, then the message keep on playing in my head about tithes. Okay, so this is the thing that God want me to share, because on the past Friday night, and it keep on lingering. And at the middle of the night, that I jot down some of the things that God want me to share. And on Saturday, I compile it and put it in the slide. So, the thing that I want to share this morning is about tithing. Okay. How many of you understand what is tithing? Can I see your hands? You understand what is tithing? Okay. Okay. Some don't really understand what is tithing. So, what is tithing? Tithing is actually give 10% of your income or of the salary that you get to God. Okay? This is called tithing. Okay? This is just a simple word. So why I say is it may be sensitive to some people, because whenever talk about or touch about money, then to some people, it may be a sensitive thing. So today I want to share about this, why Abraham tithes. As you read from your Bibles, you know and understand that the Abraham in the Bible, he tithes. To whom he tithes? Brother Herbs know very well, he tithes to Melchizedek. So today we have to study, who is this Melchizedek that he tithes to? And at the Old Testament, who was supposed to tithe? To give tithes. The people of Israel. Who did they tithes to? They give tithes to God, but that money or that offering will indeed give to the Levites. Okay. So today I want to share from Book of Hebrews chapter 7, verse 1 to 28. But one critical and also important thing that I want to bring up. Next slide. And this is when the times I pray to the Lord. When I pray and I talk to God, God say, today, I want to remove the curse of your finance. And this is the message I received from the Lord. The Lord say, I want to remove the curse of your finance. So, when someone's finance is cursed, what is the situation and what is the symptom of finance is being cursed? When someone's finance is being cursed, it's when the times they are constantly in lacking. Constantly. They mean like, it's not just one day, but continually, years after years, and week after weeks, and month after month, continuous in lacking. That one is under the curse of finance. But God say, today I want to remove the curse of your finance. He say he want to remove the curse of our finance. And he want to bless our finance. And God even promised, he say, I'm going to bless the brother and sister finance in Hope Malacca greatly. Bless them greatly. Because first thing that God wants to do is to remove the curse. And I received a message from the Lord. God said, teach my people. When at times I talked to God and I heard this word, he said, teach my people. Teach my people concerning finance. Teach my people how to handle their wealth, how to handle their money. So that they will see breakthrough in their finance. So today God wants to bless your finance, but we need to learn to surrender to God. In book of Matthew chapter 6, verse 33, and in fact in chapter 6, he said, "Seek first my kingdom and my righteousness, and all these things that you need, it will be added to you." So God says, seek first my kingdom and my righteousness. All the things that you need, it will be given to you. It will be added to you. So God wants to remove this curse, that God's people will move out from the deserts to enter into the promised land. So God wants to bring his people to enter into the promised land of milk and honey. The promised land of milk and honey is the land of abundance. So, can God's people glorify his names in the constant lacking? Or can God's people glorify his name in the borrowing state? They mean like, borrow money, and borrow money, and continuously in the lack. Obviously, it's no. And I want to share with you some critical thing. As God's people equipped with the kingdom mindset, that they will enter into the promised lands of milk and honey, no longer wander in the desert, which is lacking in terms of finance. God wants to usher his people to enter into the abundance, because he wants to glorify his own name. The key thing is he wants to glorify his own name. He wants his own name to be glorified. You know, God say, it is not by might, nor by power, but by my spirit. When you connect with God, tag to God, honor God, you flow with God, this is the area will also flow. Because finance is also spiritual. This is something we need to understand. I see very obvious from this man of God, Pastor Dr. Sim. He always give to God's kingdom, give to God's people. He always give. And God bless him a lot. In his life, he never lack of anything. He always have enough to give to other people. Because he always give, and then the flow keep on flowing into his lap. Keep on flowing in, and then he flow out. Because he always give. That's why it's always coming, and keep on coming in, and then he keep on giving out. Because the flow of finance, which is also some people call as cash flow, is actually spiritual. So, those who understand spiritual secret about finance, they will understand that in fact, finance or even money is spiritual, but against the Bible say, not the love of or the greedy of money. Okay? Because finance pour into the laps of God's people, or wealth pour into the laps of God's people, is for the advancement of his kingdom. Recently, I remind some brothers, when at times I have time of fellowship with them, I say, God wants to bless you for your finance. But the purpose and also the reason for him to bless your finance is not for you to squander it and use it for your own luxuries or for your own pleasure. God wants you to bless his kingdom. Be ready. As you learn these lessons, when you receive money from God, you learn this lesson to give to the kingdom of God. God is actually preparing you. He is testing you. See whether I can trust this man or not. If he finds you are the man that who can be trusted, then he will add unto you. Because he don't want to destroy you. He don't want to destroy you because if you are not ready, he give you a lot of money. What happened? Then you are destroyed by the money. Because you chase after the money and you crazy about the money and you lost yourself in the midst of the flow of money. So, and I know that brother, when the time I talked to him, I know that he already been tested by God. And the time will come. And it will soon come that God will transfer wealth to him because God know that this is the man that can be trusted for the finance of his kingdom to use to bless God's kingdom. So I want to come back to this. One important principle, why today God's or people in the world or even God's people suffer in order to get finance or resources. Let's take a look at the next slide. I want to bring you to Book of Genesis chapter 3, verse 17 to 19. Genesis chapter 3, verse 17. You will eat of it through painful toil all the days of your life. It will sprout weeds and thorns, and you will eat the plants of the field. You will painfully toil and sweat to produce food to eat until your body, taken from the ground, returns to the ground. This Bible verse is referring to what incident? Yeah, Brother Aaron said, this is the fall of man. It was when the times Adam and Eve sinned against God through disobedience. Because God said, don't do this. But Eve and Adam, they didn't listen to God's voice, but they listened to the voice of Satan. They listened to the voice of the serpents. They listened to the wrong party. When they hear wrongly, and resulted in the fall. So this fall, and God say, after your fall, because of your disobedience, because of your sin, this will be the result. This will be the result of your sin. So what is the result of the sin? While they were in the gardens, do you think Adam can enjoy the fruits, all the fruits in the garden? He actually can enjoy all the fruits in the garden, except the one that God say he cannot touch. Only one tree, the fruit from one tree that he cannot touch. But the rest, he can just freely eat. But when the time he touched the one that God asked him not to touch, then God said, from now on, you have to work very hard. You have to work very hard in order to have food to eat. Before that, he no need to work very hard and he can have food to eat. I just want to ask any one of you plant a fruit tree before? Any kind of fruit tree? Can I see your hands? You planted fruit tree before? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay. What kind of fruit tree you plant? Some mango, some durian, some what? Some papaya, huh? What? Coconut tree. Okay, coconut tree. Okay, coconut tree. What else? Coconut tree? Brother Herb? Sour soup. Wow, sour soup, coconut tree. Anyone else? What? Huh? Tomato. Tomato, pineapple. Okay. Huh? Durian. Okay. Die already. Did you manage to eat the fruit from the durian tree? No. Oh, you're dying. Okay. Out of all these so many trees that you plant, which one is difficult to plant? Huh? Durian. Huh? Coconut. Manage to bear fruit or not? Ah, bear fruit, then it's okay. There are no problem. So, the problem of The sin is what? You have to work very hard. Then just get a little. But when someone's finance is blessed by God, what is the situation? He just works normal, but the reward and also the return also in proportion. But under the curse is, very hard, very terrible, but yet the result is very little. That one is under curse. But God wants to remove this. Because original state is, when Adam is, he was in the garden, he plant whatever thing that he plant, he grow, then he just grow healthily. Because know what? Don't have what thing? Don't have sins, don't have virus, don't have bacteria. You know, it's, I myself try to plant, it's not easy. And because my wife plant the pineapple tree, and when the time it bear fruit, then I told my mom, you see, because I use the word, I planted, but actually my wife rebuked me, and my wife say, no, it's not you planted, I planted. Because I say, I planted, I refer to my house. My wife say, you don't even take care, you only harvest. So, pineapple tree is not easy, because it takes 2 years from raw, and before you bear fruits, at least 2 years. And then after you take the fruits, then you need to wait until another 2 years, unless you know what to do. Okay? So, there's a lot of insects or a lot of pests to attack your plant. My house, I plant some veggie and attacked by all those things, all kind of things. It's not easy, it's difficult. A few days ago, I have a talk with Brother Eric. Brother Eric, he want to rare chicken. And because he want to rare chicken at the church land, then he do some testing. He brought 100 chicken. 100 chicken, small chick. Out of 100, he rare, how many died? Aaron say, few days ago he told me 40 died. Now Aaron told me 45. 45 out of 100 survival rate. Do you think it's easy to rare chicken? Oh, you see, all say no. You understand the Bible verse, then you understand why is it so difficult. Because those chicken, once you infect, they are infected by virus or bacteria, then they spread among the chicken, then all the chicken die already. So how many people died during the COVID-19? How many million people died? These are survivors. These are survivors. So the issue of sin is very severe. You need to work very hard in order to get result. You know, there was one brother, last time he joined Hope Malacca, he is a vet. He studied in UPM and as a vet. Then he worked in a chicken farm. Chicken farm supply to KFC. Anyone eat KFC before? Or eat KFC bill. So he worked in the farm that supplied chicken to KFC. How they manage the chicken in the farm? Before going, they have to wear the jumpsuit, cover their head, cover every part of their body, and they also need to wear gloves. Then after that, need to desanitize himself and also blow. Desanitize so that he don't bring virus into the chicken farm. And the air in the chicken farm filter. You know, when the time he shared this thing to me, because I work in semiconductor industry, I only came to know, how come your practice just like semicon? Before enter, you have a shower, you need to wear the jumpsuit, but they're even critical, they need to sanitize. They need to sanitize. Okay? They need to sanitize before they enter. What happens if, let's say, if someone who do not sanitize, like me, I cough, right? I dare not to go near Richard's son. I observe from far because I don't want my, when I cough, fly, then drop. That's why I want to keep a bit distant. I worry because this baby, if let's say catch the cough, wow, the baby will suffer, mother will suffer, the father will suffer, whole family suffer. That's why it's very challenging. That's why I want to keep a bit distant. I supposed to wear mask, but I want to preach. I short of breath. Okay. So this will be the consequences. Do you see the picture behind the text? Anyone see the picture behind the text? Actually, it's a hand, which is a dirty hand. It's a dirty hand. He need to work very hard. A pair of hands. Need to work very hard in order to get food. So, next slide. What is considered blessed? This is in the Bible. Any one of you come across this Bible verse? Proverbs chapter 10, verse 22. Let me read for you. Proverbs chapter 10, verse 22. Our projector a bit sync up already, doesn't it? So, it says, the blessing of the Lord brings wealth without painful toil for it. This is what the Word of God says. It says, the blessing of the Lord brings wealth without painful toil for it. Okay, I want to ask, there are many ways to earn money. There are many ways to earn money. Some people earn money using their time. They work, they exchange their time for money. Some people earn money using money to earn money. Some people using money to earn money. Some people using other people's money to earn money. Some people using their brain to earn money. You belong to which category? Category number one, use your time to earn money, or use money to earn money, or use other people's money to earn money, or you use no money to earn money. Which category you belong to? Some people is mixture. Which one is the lowest category? The first one is the lowest category. Use your time to exchange for money. It's the lowest category. But today, God wants to expose to you the highest category is revelations and creativity from God to earn money. If you read, hopefully I remember correctly, Deuteronomy chapter 28:18. Okay, maybe someone check for me. Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 18. And someone who found it, read for us. Not this one. Maybe I remember incorrect. It's about the wealth of the wicked will be transferred to the righteous. It's Deuteronomy 18 or 28:8. Yeah. Or 18. Okay. Huh? 13:22? Oh, that one is Proverbs. Actually, one more verse is actually I forgot. That one is referring to God will give you creativity to get wealth. Okay? I will look for it and then I share with you. This is something. Look at this. This is also another very profound one. Proverbs chapter 13, verse 22. We go back to Proverbs chapter 13, verse 22. Eggs. Okay, we go back to that. Deuteronomy 8:17. Okay? Look at Deuteronomy 8:17. We come back to this later. You can see that the wealth of the sinners is stored up for the righteous. Deuteronomy 17 and 18. Okay? 8:18. And you shall remember the Lord your God, for it is He who gives you power to get wealth. In some translation, is what they say? He will give you creative mind to get wealth, that He may establish His covenant, which He swore to you, to your father, as it is this day. So, brother and sister, because I was brought up in a normal society way, the only way that I know how to earn money is use my time, my energy to exchange for money. That's the only thing that I know. Until I read the Word of God, I get new understanding. Okay? Unless I get new understanding. So, brother and sister, this is just sideline. So, sideline is what? God will give you creativity to earn money. But you no need. If you are not under curse, you no need to toil and labor so hard. Okay? Listen carefully to this. When your finance is blessed by God, you no need to work very hard. You just need to work and receive according to its proportions. Okay, go back to the slide. And this is something I want to share with you. Next slide. So do we need to tithe to Jesus? Tithing to Jesus in the New Testament. So tithes was mentioned in the Old Testament because they collect tithes and give to the Levites. And the Levites give to who? After they receive their tithes. Levites give to Aaron's family. In our church, we also have Aaron's family. Okay? Because they collect from 10% from the rest of the tribes of Israel. Then they tithes to Levite. Why they want to tithes to Levite? So that, you know what was the problem? What is the problem if, let's say, nobody tithes to God and the money give to Levites? What is the problem? Original problem was everybody busy doing their thing and also earn money to survive and feed themselves. Nobody take care of the temple of the Lord. Nobody take care of the temple of the Lord. So that's why God instituted tithes. The rest of the tribe of Israel, 11 tribes, they work. After they work, they gain, and from their gain, they pass 10% to Levite. So that Levite no need to work like the rest of the people work. The Levite can just spend their time to praise and worship God, set up the tent, and also arrange the holy communion or the holy articles in the tabernacle of God. There are showbread, table of showbread, and also lampstand, and also the altars, and also the basins for them to wash their hands, and also the burning of incense in the tabernacle of God. So all this needs people to take care. And who is the one that will take care? Levites. So therefore, why today you can see churches, they are full-time worker in the church. Okay, full-time worker in the church. Why there are full-time worker in the church? So that there are people pay attention to the issue and also the work in the church. So what kind of work in the church where need people to pay attention? Let's say like collect the data of the church members and also know whose birthday, what time, and when, collect their number, and then compile and put in the data sheet. And then after that, during their birthday, organize a birthday for them. So it's a form of pastoral care. Okay, it's a form of pastoral care, take care of the people in the church. Someone who manages the administrations in the church. And also liaises with external party while the rest of the people are working. So we need people like this to take care of the administrations of the church. Send email, reply email, collect data, and also collect information, register, all kinds of things. We need, okay? We need people to pay attention, to focus on this work. And this is the work of Levite. So this is also the reason why there are churches, they have full-time worker. In Hope Malacca, we have zero full-time worker. Okay, we have zero full-time worker. And in fact, nobody really focused on this area as of now. And also, people like coordinates in terms of water baptisms and also water baptism certificates. All the things that we do is whenever there's needs, then we just attend to it. But a lot of things that we have not done. Tons of things if we want to grow the church to more than 100 or 200 people, we need people stand in the gap to do the administration work. And in fact, normally who do this is sometimes I get Mary to do, sometimes I get Abigail to do. Then sometimes few people do this thing. But in fact, to attend to the need is insufficient because it requires a lot of energy and also time and even immediate focus. I share this is so that God's people can understand the needs of the church. Okay, the needs of the church. Because I want to call people into full-time. I want to call people into full-time to serve in the church. But I want us to pay, but as a church, we don't want to give short to the full-time worker in the church. We want this full-time worker not to be worried when the time they serve in the church. So, you know, there are people who work full-time in other churches. They suffer financially. Why I say they suffer financially? Because the church feel that, oh, we pay you. Because they have wrong concept. What is the wrong concept is, we pay you. So therefore, you are our staff or slave or servant. I tell you this is the wrong concept. Okay? But if someone is willing to do work full time for the work and also the service of the Lord, this is a praiseworthy thing. Okay? It's a praiseworthy thing. And we need to honor those who lay down their life for the service of the Lord. Okay? So we need to honor such kind of people. I want to call this kind of person, but the philosophy of the ministry of our church is what? We don't simply engage anyone to become full-time worker, especially those who are very free. No. I will not involve anyone who is very free to become full-time worker. Because once they become full-time worker, they are also very free. They do not know what to do in the church. The rest of the people all go to work. They come to church. I'm full-time worker, and therefore I need to clock in. I come to church. But I do not know what I'm supposed to do. This is not the full-time worker that I want. We will only engage what kind of full-time worker? The one already served fully. Listen carefully. The one already served fully. Until they don't have time, they feel that their time is insufficient, only this kind of person is qualified to serve full-time in Hope Malacca. Not the one who is very free, I'm very free, I just want to earn my living, then I become full-time worker. No. Hope Malacca will not allow this thing to happen. Not because you come full-time, not because you want to get salary. You come full-time, not because you are very free. You come full-time because you have limited time to serve God. So in Hope Church is, who will become a life group leader? Appoint and give a title to become life group leader. It's only the one who already function. When the time we give them a title, just because they already function. So we won't appoint someone to become a life group leader or become pastor just because he is very free, just because he studied and come back from the Bible school. No. This is not the practice in Hope Malacca. Not because someone come back from the Bible school, then we will appoint them to become pastor. This is not what we do. The way we do is, you already serve fully. We see that you don't have time. You need more time to serve God. We invite them to come to become full-time worker. This is how we function. Because we don't want someone to come into the church, become full-time worker, whole day sit there, do not know what to do. But the full-time worker, the first full-time worker come into Hope Malacca. One, this person step into the full-time service, he just continue to do what he already do and continue to do more. Everyone understand this? I want to make this very clear. Because I want to lay a very solid, strong foundations for our church for future. Because we intend to house nations. People from different nations, people from Africa, people from Europe, people from Southeast Asia, people from Asia. We intend to bless many people. Hundreds and thousands of people. So therefore, at the beginning, the foundations of the church have to be right. If the foundation of the church is not right, when the time we build, halfway the church will collapse. We don't want the church to become very big already, then after that collapse. We want to make sure we lay a strong foundation at the very beginning. That's why God inspired me. He said, my son, I want to bless. I want to bless Hope Malacca. But I want you to teach your people in terms of finance. He said, my sons, I intend to bless you so much. But your enemy come and accuse you. Your enemy come and accuse you and say that, God, this person is not qualified. He does not deserve that kind of finance outpouring to him. He's not, because your enemy is condemning and accusing. And I want to lift this curse. I want to lift this curse from the people of your church. I want to lift this curse. So that your enemy cannot accuse you. So that your enemy cannot accuse you. And he talked to me. He said, my sons, do not be afraid to talk about this. Because I want to do great things for this church. Do not be afraid to talk about this. You may think that when you talk about this, then the people may be offended. He said, my son, I have called you to do this. Do not be afraid to hold back the word that I want you to speak to the people. Because I'm going to pour out my spirit in this church. And therefore, you need to prepare them. If you don't prepare them, they will phase out. They will miss my outpouring. On Friday, this thing lingering, I cannot sleep well. I woke up Saturday morning, 3 a.m. Then, no choice, I have to continue to type whatever thing that God put. Then I put in my phone all the Bible verse and also the thing that he put in my heart. Then I check the Bible verse, then I put in the thing that he told me. Then I just quickly, 3 o'clock in the morning, I put down. Then I say, God, a bit tired already. I think I want to sleep. I say, then I wait until 4 something, then I sleep for a while. And then 5 o'clock, my alarm ring. I need to go to prayer already. I say, oh God, a bit tired. I want to go to mountain to pray already, 5 o'clock in the morning. Then I let it ring, ring, ring until 5:30. Only then I wake up. I was late for the prayer. When the time I reached the mountain already, 6 o'clock. I supposed to reach there at 5:30 in the morning to pray. But this is the message that God told me to share with the people. So therefore, go to Book of Hebrews, chapter 7, verse 1 to 7. This Melchizedek was king of Salem and priest of God Most High. He met Abraham, returning from the defeat of the kings, and blessed him. And Abraham gave him a tenth of everything. First, the name Melchizedek means the king of righteousness, then also king of Salem, means king of peace, without father or mother, without genealogy, without beginning of days or end of life. Resembling the Son of God, he remains a priest forever. So by the way, who is this Melchizedek? Yeah. Richard say, Melchizedek is Jesus. Jesus Christ is in the order of Melchizedek. Abraham gave tithes to who? Abraham gave tithes to who? Melchizedek. Who is Levites? Who gave tithes to Levites? The rest of the people of Israel. And Levites give their tithes to who? Aaron. Who is Aaron? Their leaders, the priests. Aaron was a high priest. Aaron was a high priest who led all the priesthood. Who is Aaron to Abraham? What is the relationship of Abraham and Aaron? Okay, who want to give the answer? What is the relationship of of Abraham and Aaron? Wow, you better read your Bible. Huh? Abraham is the ancestor of people of Israel. Abraham was an ancestor of people of Israel that went to the land of Israel but moved to the land of Egypt, and from land of Egypt enter into the promised land. What is the gap of Abraham? What is the gap of Abraham to Aaron? At least several hundred years. So, when Abraham gave tithes, do you think where was Aaron? Not yet born. So, tithes in the Old Testament is a law, right? Correct? So therefore, tithes was established before the law. This is something that I want to share with everyone. Listen carefully. Before the law, there was tithes. Tithes was before the law. So some may say the Old Testament thing is Old Testament. The New Testament didn't mention about tithes. Book of Hebrews is in Old Testament or New Testament? It's in New Testament. But it refers to even the thing before the law of tithes was established. So tithes was established, and the tithes was given to who? Abraham gave tithes to who? Melchizedek. And who is this Melchizedek? This Melchizedek is God himself. Why I have to go all these details to share this is so that we can understand where the spirit of tithes is coming from. And when Jesus Christ came, what did he say? He said, I come not to abolish the law, but to fulfill the law. So, how did Jesus fulfill the law? Jesus came not to fulfill the iota and also the dot of the law, but he came to fulfill the spirit of the law. Now we get it? So tithes, what is the spirit of tithes? This is the most important thing instead of just tithes itself. So, the spirit of tithings is what? It's honoring God. So the key thing is honor God. So continue on with Hebrews chapter 7, verse 4 to 10. Just think how great he was. Even the patriarch, Abraham, gave him a tenth of the plunder. Now the law requires the descendants of Levi, who become priests, to collect a tenth from the people, that is from their fellow Israel, even though they also are descended from Abraham. This man, however, did not trace his descent from Levi, yet he collected a tenth from Abraham and blessed him who had the promise. So this was the incident where Abraham gave tithes to King of Salem. He gave tithes to Melchizedek. And verse 7, and without doubt, the lesser is blessed by the greater. In one case, the tenth is collected by the people who die, but in the other case, by him who is declaring to be living. Okay, verse 8. How to understand verse 8? In one case, the tenth is collected by the people who die. Who already died? The people before Abraham already died. But by him who declared to be living is actually referring to Jesus. Because Jesus is still alive. So one might even say that Levi, who collects the tenth, paid the tenth through Abraham. Because when Melchizedek met Abraham, Levi was still in the body of his ancestor. Actually, the Bible makes it very clear. Everything is displayed in the Word of God. Okay? People of Israel collect their tenth, give their tenths to Levi. Levi give their tenths to Aaron. Aaron give their tenths to God. And his ancestor is Abraham. Abraham give the tenths to Salem, King of Salem. Who is this King of Salem? This King of Salem is Jesus himself. So this is the way that how we trace. We trace back to God. How do we know that Jesus is Melchizedek? As you continue to read, as you finish reading book of Hebrews chapter 7, then you will know that Jesus is Melchizedek. Let's continue on. Next slide. If perfection could have been attained through the Levitical priesthood, and indeed the law given to the people established that priesthood, why was there still need for another priest to come? One in the order of Melchizedek, not in the order of Aaron. What does it mean? Order of Aaron is the order of law. Order of Melchizedek is the order of spirit. So, we have to understand the order of Aaron is an order of law. It's required. Die, no matter how, you have to give 10. If you don't give, then straightway strike that. During that time, it was very straightforward. Strike that. But the spirit of tithes under the covenant of Melchizedek is actually the giving of the spirit, the tithes of the spirit. So later I will come to that. What is the tithes of the spirit? When the priesthood is changed, the law must be changed also. So, the fixed law of Old Testament is faded, but is replaced by the spirit of tithings and givings, and also all the rest of the law. So, he of whom these things are said belong to different tribe, and no one from that tribe has ever served at the altar. Okay, this one, all of us, we need to understand very clearly. For it is clear that our Lord descended from Judah. And in regard to that tribe, Moses said nothing about priests. Actually, this Bible verse is talking about what? It's talking about Jesus in the order of Melchizedek. Okay? It's actually talking about why Jesus received tithes. Why Melchizedek received tithes. It's because this one is in the order of spirit. And what we have said is even more clear. If another priest like Melchizedek appears, one who has become a priest, not on the basis of a regulation as to his ancestry, but on the basis of the power of an indestructible life. I'm not sure how many of you understand this scripture. Let me try to make it in a simpler way. Whatever you say here, it just point at Jesus, the Melchizedek in the Old Testament, before the law was established, was actually referring to Jesus. This is the simple way to put it. But to run through here is to say that because God sees the people cannot comply to the law. God sees that the people cannot comply to the law. And therefore, he opened the door and teach his people the spirit of the law. So, one of the Ten Commandments is what? One of the Ten Commandments is do not commit adultery, correct? And then what Jesus Christ said? Jesus said, if you look at the woman lustfully and you already committed adultery with her in your heart. So, any further, Jesus said, I come not to abolish the law, but to fulfill the law. So what actually Jesus said is, I want you to see and to understand the spirit of the law of Ten Commandments. I want you to see and to understand the spirit of the laws of tithes. Something more than the tithes. Something more than the Ten Commandments. Which is the spirit of the Ten Commandments. Which is the spirit of tithes. So therefore, the spirit of tithes is what? Okay, go back to the do not commit adultery. The spirit of do not commit adultery is what? Even when someone imagine he is having sexual immoral act, already sin. How many of you, we understand and we can agree with that? When you imagine you having sex with someone, already sin. Already violated the spirit of the Ten Commandments. So therefore, in the New Testament, what God said? In the Old Testament, Ten Commandments is what? do not steal. God say do not steal, right? Correct? What is the spirit of do not steal? What is the spirit of do not steal? Do not covet the property of another person. So if let's say someone thinks you try to manipulate and also take advantage of them and then take their things, is actually already violate the spirit of the Ten Commandments, even though you do not literally steal. So why, this is the reason why we don't agree with giving bribe. When someone give bribe and someone give bribe to us, shall we receive? The answer is definitely no. This is also the reason why our brother and also one of the sister, they resign from their company. Because when they work in the workplace, someone give them money and even send to house one stack of money and in the envelope and pass to her. You take this money, then after that, next time you keep quiet lah. You cannot say and you don't say anything. Then you just approve our project. And if let's say that brother, he take the money, then he just keep quiet lah. Then whatever hanky-panky they want to do, you know, in most of some company, those who are purchaser, what is their advantage? The supplier will what? You give me this project, then he will give gifts. When you go for holiday, then I pay for your hotel, your lodging. I tell you, this still happened in Malacca. But the brother and sister in our church stood their ground. Because they understand the spirit of the law. They are not just fulfilling the law, but they are fulfilling the spirit of the law. And God said, unless your righteousness surpasses what? Unless your righteousness surpasses the righteousness of the teacher of the law and also Pharisees, or else you cannot inherit the kingdom of God. This is what God says. Unless your righteousness surpasses the righteousness of the Pharisees. So the Pharisees comply to the law. But God wants us to comply and even far beyond the spirit of the law. So, brother and sister, what is the spirit of the law? The spirit of the law, ultimate, is to glorify God, honor Him. This is the spirit of the law. We honor Him or who He is. Let's continue to read Book of Hebrews chapter 7, verse 17 to 25. For it is declared, you are priests forever in the order of Melchizedek. Who is a priest forever? Jesus. The former regulation is set aside because it was weak and useless. For the law made nothing perfect. And a better hope is introduced by which we draw near to God. And it was not without an oath. Others became priests without an oath, but he became a priest with an oath when God said to him, the Lord has sworn and will not change his mind. You are a priest forever. Who is a priest forever? Jesus Christ. Because of this oath, Jesus has become the guarantor of a better covenant, which is the covenant with God Himself, which is the covenant of the Spirit. So that's why I don't break the covenant with God. The covenant of God is yes and amen, and is established forever and ever. Once God make covenant with His people, God is not like people who violate the contract. When you rent your house to other people, if let's say someone want to violate the contract and do not fulfill the contract, they can just break the contract. And even people who married, if let's say they cannot live together, then they just divorce. Man is easily violated the contract, but not so. God's covenant is not like the contract of man. Once God establishes his covenant with his people, it lasts forever and ever. God honors his covenant. Even how hard it is, he will still pay the price to fulfill his covenant. That's why Jesus Christ had to pay the price, even die on the cross. Because Jesus Christ wants to fulfill the covenant of the Father with the people of Israel. So therefore, the God's covenant with Israel is forever. It's a forever covenant that God has made. So, you can see verse 23. Now, there have been many of those priests since death prevented them from continuing in office. What God actually say? When the times, why they want to offer sacrifices, why they want to offer sin offerings and also burnt offering to God. They offer all those offerings is so that they will not receive the punishment of sin. The punishment of sin is death. Why every time they have to get the priest to offer? In order their sin will not be counted by God. So therefore they offer all kinds of things. When they offer all kinds of things, they are safe. But every year, when you sin again, you have to offer again. When you sin again, you have to offer again. And because of their sin, they repeatedly offer again and again and again and again. But the one that who once and for all is who? Jesus Christ. Because he is from the beginning. He is the Alpha, he is also the Omega. So therefore, when Jesus Christ offers sacrifice one, he no need to offer sacrifice for the second time. He no need to offer sacrifice for the second time. Once and for all. Once and for all. That's why the office of Jesus Christ as the high priest is a priest in the spirit. Priest in the spirit which continue and long lasting forever and ever. Let's continue with verse 24 and to 25. But because Jesus lives forever, he has a permanent priesthood. Therefore, he is able to save completely those who come to God through him, because he always lives to intercede for them. Such a high priest truly meets our needs. One who is holy, blameless, pure, set apart from sinners, exalted above the heaven. Unlike the other high priest, he does not need to offer sacrifices day after day. This is a very beautiful. Verse 27. Unlike the other high priest. What other high priest? During those times, the high priest was Aaron. And also those Levites. He does not need to offer sacrifices day after day. First for his own sin and then for the sins of the people. He sacrificed for their sin once for all when he offered himself. So therefore, Jesus Christ is so powerful in our lives. You know, some people say that they know Jesus. But if their Jesus is different from our Jesus, then their Jesus is not your Jesus. Our Jesus is the one that who offered sacrifice for us. Once and for all. You know, because of this Jesus, because of Jesus, and therefore today, we have the privilege to enjoy abundant life. If you have this understanding, if you understand that Jesus already paid all the price for your sin, If this understanding come to you, okay, if this understanding come to you, when you work, the result of your work will come in a proportional way. If you understand the finished work of the Lord Jesus Christ, and then when the time you give to God, it's no longer in the giving of law, but you will give from the Spirit. But most of the time, the one that from the Spirit always outdo the law. Let me share this again. The one who give from the Spirit outdo the law. They are not under the law, but yet they outdo the law. I want to show you this picture. Abraham offered to Melchizedek. And who is this Melchizedek? This Melchizedek is Jesus himself. Jesus is in the order of Melchizedek. Next slide. Tidings is an act of obedience and also an act of honoring God. When did I learn how to tithe? I became a believer at the year of 1992. At that time, a bit challenging because I was a student. Whenever I go to church, when the offering bag passed to me, then I give whatever I can afford, I give. But I bit struggle during that time because actually I don't receive allowance from my parents. Even during the for my case is only when the time I need anything at school, I just tell my father, then he will just pay for it. But I don't have daily allowance as I go to school. I'm not sure the rest of you. I'm not the one that who have daily allowance to go to school on. Even when the times I go to uni, when I was in uni, I even worked for my own living. And I used the loan to pay for my tuition fee. But definitely for sure, my father also pay for my living. But whenever I go for church camp, I have to work. Work for money, and then after that, I pay for my church camp or whatever thing that I want to do. That's my life. And during my uni time, because I joined Hope JB during that time, I was introduced to the concept of tithings. When I started to tithe, not during secondary school time, but during my uni time, I learned to tithe as a student. How a student tithes, when the time you get your salary, you tithe. Or when the times I get my loan, let's say like my PTPTN loan, and from the loan, 10% give to God. That was, you know, I learned how to tithe while I was a student, not because when the time I was a working adult. So when the times I learned how to tithe as a student, when the time I become a working adult, my salary, first salary was 3,000 ringgit. How much should I tithe? 300 ringgit, right? So, was there any problem for me to tithe during that time? The answer was no. Because during my uni time, I already learned to tithe on a monthly basis. So when the times, I just come out to work, no problem for me to tithe. When the times my salary doubled or tripled from the beginning, when the time I came out from school, do you think I have problem to tithe? When the times you need to tithe more than 1,000, do you Do you think it's a problem? So, brother and sister, we need to learn from young, okay, tidings. Because God spoke to me very clearly about this. On past Friday, I have, before I sleep, this thing, God keep on talking to me. Then when the time I sleep, 3 o'clock, I don't know why 3 o'clock I have to wake up. Then God say, jot down this. I say, oh God. He asked me to, oh, then I have to write. After 1 hour only then, okay, finish already. You can go to sleep. This is the middle of the night message that God gave to me. He said, I want to bless the church. I want to give Hope Malacca a building. But I want you to teach my people. And that's the thing that God told me. I want you to teach my people. Very clear. And just like on Friday prayer meeting, for the past Friday prayer meeting, I heard God's voice like very loud at my ear. Because normally God speaks to me is very soft. But for the past Friday, He spoke to me quite loud. Even during the prayer meeting, He like, same thing that He spoke to me several times, like continue, like, wow, until I, no choice, I have to obey and just say what he want me to say on the past Friday prayer meeting. This is a bit unusual because normally God speak to me very, very soft. Very, very soft and very, very small, still voice. But past Friday and also Saturday morning was a bit unusual. The way that God spoke to me is a bit louder than usual. So, in fact, tithing is an act of obedience and also the way for us to honor God. And in fact, there is a lot of things to share, but today I will just stop here. I will just stop here. And when time permits, in other times, I will continue. You know, there was a word of prophecy prophesied over me and say, son, I say, sons, you will teach Hope Malacca about finance. I say, God, how am I going to teach God's people about finance? And after that, God said, son, I want you to write a book about finance. I say, God, how, why you want me to write a book about finance? I said, God, I don't have idea. I don't know what to write. You want me to write books about finance? I don't know what to write. But there was one night. There was one night. God spoke to me. Then again, he quickly asked me to, I had to jot down. Then I already wrote 5 chapters about finance. Kingdom finance. I wrote 5 chapters. Because God want me to publish that book about finance. I still hold back. I say, God, I wrote already, but whether to publish or not, when God time come, I will release a book about kingdom finance. Because God already triggered me at least twice. Both are nighttime. He asked me to prepare. Write about the kingdom finance. And actually, this was the thing that I received from God. Actually, it's more than that. God gave me a lot of things. I only share maybe less than 5% of the 100%. You know, when the times I received this thing from God, I do not know what to say, you know. I even asked God, when you want me to share with the people? I received the first message, I think 2 months ago. Then on this Friday, God triggered again, and then more details came out. The Friday, or Saturday morning. So, brother and sister, are you ready for the outpouring of the finance that God wants to pour into your laps? You know, many times, Brother Ken talk about new wineskin. This is also one of the things only the new wineskin can contain. The old wineskins cannot contain this outpouring of the finance. If they remain with the old wineskins, it will burst. It will burst. But those who are ready to transform and renew themselves, they will receive the new wine. So let me share again. Tidings is an act of obedience and also an act of honor towards the Lord our God. Why not we pray? Thank you, Lord Jesus. Heavenly Father, let God your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Touch the heart of your people. Touch the heart of your people. Transform us into a new wineskin so that we may contain the new wine, the outpouring of your new wine to us. Thank you, Heavenly Father. All glory be unto you, Lord. All honor be unto you. Brother and sister, this morning, God wants to call you to obey Him. God calls you to honor Him. God says, my son, my daughter, I call you to obey me and honor me through your tithes and offering. I call you to honor me through your tithes and offering so that my house will be full, so that my house will be filled. And he said, my son and daughter, do not just take care of your own house, but neglect the house of the Lord. Do not just take care of your own house with the brand new furniture, but neglect the house of the Lord. Do not just renovate your own house, but neglect the house of the Lord. Do not just put up things, nice things for your own house, but neglect the house of the Lord. But honor the Lord. And you will see, how will I honor you? And you will see, how will I honor you? If the Lord had touched your heart, you can respond to the Lord this morning. It is just between you and God. It is just between you and God. It is just between you and God. And you just respond to the Lord and say, God, I know it may be difficult for me, but I want to respond to you, Lord. I want to honor you with my tithes and offering. I don't want to short give you. Lord, help me, Lord. Sometimes I don't even have enough for myself. I don't even have enough for my family. Lord, how can I give these tithes? How can I give these tithes? But the Lord said, my son, test me in this. See, will I not pour into your laps? Pour and shake and press down. And he said, my son, test me in this. And you will see, how can I meet all your needs? Let the Holy Spirit talk to you. Let God speak to you. And you can respond to God. To some of you who have softened your heart, you may take this time, respond to God and say, God, here am I. I'm going to honor you with my wealth. I'm going to honor you with my wealth. God, you can count on me. You can trust me with your wealth. I'm going to honor you.
Jesus, you're the center.
If this is your desire, talk to the Lord. It is just between you and God at this moment, at this time. If you have prayed to the Lord, I'd like to invite all of us to stand. Just sing this song as an offering unto the Lord, our God.
Center of it all. From beginning to the end, it will always be, always be you, Jesus. Jesus. Nothing else, nothing else matters. Nothing in this world will do. You're the center. Everything revolves around you. Jesus, you. From my heart to the heaven. Jesus, be the center. It's all about you. Yes, it's all about you. From my heart heaven, Jesus be the center, it's all about you, yes, it's all about you. Jesus, I believe in you. Jesus, I belong to you. You're the reason that I live. And then I see singing, Jesus, I believe. Jesus, I belong to you. You're the reason that I live, the reason that I sing with all I am.
Heavenly Father, we give thanks to you for such a wonderful time and also for such a wonderful message you want to deliver to your people. Thank you, Heavenly Father, because you love your church so much and you love your people so much. Father in heaven, I want to declare from today onwards, all the curses of finance shall be lifted in Jesus' name. All the curses shall be lifted. That our brother and sister will no longer suffer the financial lacking. In the name of the Lord Jesus.
Amen.
The curse shall be lifted in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Let us give a clap offering to the Lord. Thank you, Jesus.